GNAT Project Manager, Part 13, Programming Scenarios 2, 3, 4, and 5. Scenario 2 shows how to abandon work on a unit that has been checked out and modified. In the current situation, three units have been transferred from the release to the workspace, checked out of version control, and modified. Two of these units belong to component AO1. The other one belongs to component AO3. We will keep the changes to AO1. However, the changes made to AO3 will be abandoned. The first step is to undo the checkout of the AO3 support file. This will discard any changes, restore the unit to the previous version, and set access to read-only. However, as long as AO3 support remains in the source file's attribute list of the workspace project, it will be visible. To remove AO3 support from the workspace, mark the unit, right-click, and in the context menu, execute the command Remove from Extending Project. This will cause a dialog box to appear. Since we are not dealing with a unit that was copied, click the button labeled Do Not Delete. The selected unit will disappear from the workspace and reappear in the release view. Don't forget to execute the Save All command every now and then. In Scenario 3, we import a new unit into a component. Components reside in modules, and modules reside in framework and application layers. Now, adding a new unit to a component in a module in the framework is not something normally done by an application developer. Therefore, we will locate the unit in the application layer within module A, which contains four components. If we are not authorized to change the arrangement and visibility of the components in module A, we cannot, for example, locate the new unit in AO3 and import it from AO4, since this would change the architecture. Instead, we shall locate the new unit in component AO4 and use it from there. The point I'm trying to make here is that the software architecture is very important and must be respected and maintained in order to prevent a well-designed system from decaying into a big ball of mud. This anti-pattern is unfortunately a common occurrence, especially in large legacy systems, which have seen years of unregulated growth and have been repeatedly subjected to repair in an expedient manner. Developers in a position to do so will refuse to work on such systems, resulting in high turnover rates that only make the problem worse. Anyway, getting back to scenario 3. Now that we know where the new unit will reside, we select the module A, component AO4 filter. Component AO4 in the release currently contains three units, one of which is the main program. At this stage in the scenario, the workspace is currently void of any units. The new unit will be imported and used by the main program, AO4.ADB. In order to modify this file, it must be transferred to the workspace, an activity that has already been demonstrated. I'll let you read these steps at your own pace. However, note that the generated body stub in step 2D contains two very important statements, namely pragma, compile time warning with some parameters, and raise program error with a string message. These statements will cause the compiler to issue a warning that assert 2 is unimplemented. This ensures that the missing implementation will not be forgotten and end up in production. After completing step 2, the workspace in the project will look like this. Here we see the main program, which was transferred to the workspace from the release, and the units just created. Step 3 contains three parts, which I'll let you read at your own pace. In scenario 4, we remove a unit from component AO4 that exists in the release. Of course, we cannot physically delete a unit from the read-only release, but we can hide it using an attribute designed specifically for that purpose. There are two forms of this attribute, excluded source list file and excluded source files. This scenario uses the first form, which references an external file that contains a list of units no longer required. To read the steps, you'll need to pause the video since I'm moving on to the next slide. In scenario 5, we temporarily override a unit that exists on the release and version drives to make some experimental changes. Since the changes might be discarded, we don't want to involve the version control system. Sometimes developers need a sandbox in which to experiment, and for that purpose, we have the source directory in the workspace. In addition to providing a temporary location for new application units, the source directory also provides the ability to override one or more units that exist on the release and version drives. We can make changes to units in the workspace's source directory without having to change the state of the corresponding units in the version control and requirements tracking system, which in some projects might require a lot of bureaucratic steps that you won't need to go through if your experiment doesn't yield the desired result. As for the code that didn't work, well, just delete it from the source directory. This feature is typically used in the following instances. 1. Make several changes to one or more units in a debugging session to help track down the cause of a problem, which is not located in the units being changed. It is understood from the beginning that these changes will be thrown away once the cause of the problem is found. 2. Perform aggressive and potentially risky refactoring on selected units where the refactoring could possibly break the code. 3. Experiment with a new algorithm or data structure. If the experiment works as planned, then okay. Use the formal process to introduce the change into the code base. But if it doesn't work, then simply delete the code. The ability to override existing units in the scratchpad area of the development environment is an important feature, especially when developing safety-critical applications where any change, even an unreserved checkout, might be subject to complex version control and requirements tracking processes. Okay, let's begin by selecting a component such as component 01 in module B. To experiment with a change to the unit, without having to check out a version control, select the radio button, W/source, then click the copy button to create a copy of the unit in the workspace. The selected unit is no longer visible in the release. Instead, a copy is now in the workspace, where we are now free to make experimental changes in a private area, which is isolated from the outside world, so to speak. Here is the code before the experiment and after, which for the purposes of this demo are only cosmetic changes. Now, if the experiment worked and we choose to keep the changes, then we can proceed with the formal change management process with complete confidence that we don't need to undo several steps because we know that the changes work. Don't forget to clean up the source directory after each experiment. After clicking the delete button, the unit is physically removed from W/source and appears once again in the release view. This is the end of part 13.